Welcome to Dead Talk, the podcast where we dissect one Grateful Dead song at a time. Join me as we explore the history, meaning, and musical composition of their classic tracks. Whether you're a longtime Deadhead or curious newcomer, there's always something new to discover about the music of the Dead. So sit back, relax, and let's dive deep into the world of the Grateful Dead. All right, welcome to Dead Talk, episode 10. I'm your host, Noah Smith, and today's guest is a Colorado native that has been roaming the fine streets of South City, St. Louis the last couple years, playing any music established he can step his foot into. Almost any given night of the week, you can catch this lad absolutely destroying the electric guitar on an improvised solo to certain classics from the 60s and 70s, or even an original piece of rock and roll music. He and his band, the Hamiltons, are frequent flyers at hip venues such as Venice Cafe and the Broadway Oyster Bar, but are also no strangers to the bigger stages like Chesterfield Amphitheater or the Jefferson Barracks Amphitheater, where they will be performing alongside St. Louis's original Dead act for over 20 years, Jake's Leg, later this summer on July 29th. Please welcome to the show, Mr. Hunter Hamilton.
Hey, well, thank you so much for having me, man. Absolutely excited to be on this beautiful Dead Talk podcast.
Yeah, sweet. Thanks, man.
Yeah, absolutely. Nice intro, too. Yeah.
I take a lot of time into those, you know, do my research, see what I can say.
Yeah, absolutely.
Try to take them pretty seriously, make you feel welcome here in my house.
Hey, very cool. Yeah, beautiful studio we got here.
This is the first one in this new setting in my house that I'm trying out.
Yeah.
I was doing most of them in my kitchen, and now we're upstairs.
Yeah, upstairs. It's a little toasty, so if you see us sweating as well.
I had to turn the AC unit off because I didn't want it in the background, you know.
Yeah, we're professionals here, you know.
We are professionals.
Yeah, strive for perfection, just like the Grateful Dead.
Absolutely. Man, I thought I was the youngest actual Deadhead until I met you. You're a little bit younger than I am, and probably a little bigger of a Deadhead than I am.
Oh man, I don't know. You follow Dead and Company around, you know.
I did. It was only for one summer, though.
Yeah. What year was that?
2016.
Nice. Yeah, I think 2016 was the only year I didn't see him. Yeah, I've seen him every other tour. Yeah, that they've been on.
I've seen at least something on every tour.
Yeah.
That tour I did, I saw 11 shows. I got into 10 of them.
Nice. Hell yeah. Yeah, busking as well, correct?
Yeah, usually. I would, my tactic after I figured it out was just like flying a sign next to the box office and just play a bunch of Dead songs.
Yeah.
It worked out a lot better than
I Need a Miracle.
Absolutely. That works like one time. But I was like, I got to figure out like a system.
Yeah, you don't want to miss them all.
All of these, yeah.
Are you going to go and see them this year?
I am planning on it. I currently don't have tickets, and it's sold out. But I was looking at StubHub, and it seems pretty easy to get like an aftermarket one.
Yeah, I reckon. And you know, there's always ones for sale, you know. So I'm going to try and go to this year as well. Yeah,
it's our last chance.
Yeah, it really is, man. Yeah, it's a bummer that Dead & Company's going to be gone, you know, after this year. But I mean, what a run, though! Unbelievable.
Yeah. About 8 years, I think.
Absolutely, yeah. And with John Mayer introduced a whole new audience, you know, to Dead & Company.
For sure.
But still, the magic lives on, you know.
It does, yeah. I think they'll maybe form a new coalition of, like, different members, as they have been since Jerry died.
Yeah.
I see John Mayer, like, staying involved in some sort of way.
Yeah, man, am I right? Billy isn't on the tour this year, right?
Right, yeah. That's maybe, like, why they're not, and I can kind of see them doing a new thing just without him.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know?
Yeah,
maybe like a different bass player and keyboard player, but I bet Bob and John start.
Oh, you think they're
going
to keep going
with like different drummers or something?
Yeah,
that's my guess.
Well, I hope so, man, because he really like adds a different flavor. A lot of people are against him and stuff, but I'm 100% for it. You know, it's like I don't know. He's playing too bluesy or something on this. You know, who cares? What? Like, that's the whole point of the Dead's music. You know,
like it changes and evolves with the times.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely.
So, as you know, here on the show on Dead Talk, we just choose one song. Well, we don't choose a song. I make you choose a song, and today you chose what song, and why did you choose this particular song?
Yeah, so I chose the other one. And to clarify, like, just the part that Bobby sings, which we found out is technically the rounder, the faster they go, the rounder they get. Yeah,
yeah, let's pull that up. The faster we go, the rounder we get.
Yeah.
Which was part of this whole original, or on Anthem of the Sun, that came out in,
yep,
in 1968. It was like this whole conglomerate, like four different songs.
Absolutely.
Right?
And then the only one they really carried on after the album came out was just the faster they go, the rounder they get, which was then to become the other one, you know. And the, and then you can see it on Skull and Roses, if I'm right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was on, let's see, the original one, I feel like, is the Fillmore East in New York, April 28th, 1971, which was on School of Roses.
With the big, long drum intro. Yeah.
Yeah, that's how kind of like how we have come to
Absolutely.
Know it now.
Yeah, well, I chose this song because, you know, I don't know. One, it's like one of Bobby's first, like, compositions, you know, that he, like, put into work lyric-wise,
yeah, like
everything
him
like
and Bill,
that.
Right?
Yep, him and Bill, which explains the crazy time signature, the 8:12 or something. Yeah, you'll see us try to tackle that a little later. It's a lot without a full set of drums, but, you know. Yeah, but and I chose it because, I don't know, I really feel like it captures the spirit that, like, the Dead was founded under, you know, like the Merry Pranksters and that, like, whole environment of, like, the acid test and San Francisco during that era. And you can, like, really tell by looking into the lyrics, you know, it's something else. And it like, immortalizes one of my favorite, you know, beatnik heroes, Neil Cassady. Yeah.
Right, yeah. This is kind of, like, unapologetically, like, about him.
Yeah, his ode, you know. Yeah. Essentially, yeah.
I read something on Deadnet this morning when I was kind of getting ready for our podcast episode where, like, the main, from, like, the faster we go, the whatever we were calling it.
The rounder they get.
Yeah. The rounder they get.
What a title.
The first, like, performance of it kind of coming as, like, the other one that we know today was the same night that Neil Cassady died.
Yeah, I have that written down as well, the February 3rd, 1968.
They played it that night with the same lyrics and I guess decided they were going to start calling it the other one. And early the morning of February 4th, I guess, at whatever time in the morning Neil Cassady died. So that's just kind of like a really coincidental relationship between a song that was about the guy when you're like the song started, the guy died. So it is kind of like his legacy. It's honestly like
it's kind of like otherworldly. Wild, man. And especially for an otherworldly person as well. Like, you know,
he was tuned into something that you know, we'll never really tap into, I think.
You've seen that Netflix documentary.
The other one?
Yeah, the other one. Where he talks about it. He's like, you know, every time I play it now, like, he's in there. He's in the song. Like, his spirit is, like, present all around, you know? It's like, it's kind of wild. I mean, the Dead are a wild band anyway, but to think about, like, you know, a soul like that captured in a song, man, is wild. Yeah.
It's like sixth or seventh dimensional almost. Like, you can't make this shit up or like plan for it, or like, these are just like really crazy stories that make this band like as legendary as they are because of this
unexplainable
like nuances.
Yeah, and a little more about Neil Cassady. I mean, I don't know, whoever's listening to this probably like may not or may know, but he was Dean Moriarty in On the Road, the main character of On the Road. Yeah, so like someone that's been completely present throughout the entirety of like beatnik culture and then like the early movements and like, you know, drove Ken Kesey's
The
bus.
Further Bus, which was Bob's second band, I think, right after Jerry died.
Oh, Further, yeah. Did you ever see him as a little baby?
I did not, no. The bus got on for me after I got on the bus after they were done doing their thing.
Yeah, absolutely.
Which is a line from this song. This is like, that's kind of like a reoccurring kind of statement or settlement in like hippie culture, like, oh, and the bus got on. And,
yeah, honestly, at some point, we should just look at the lyrics and analyze it during this.
I have them right here, yeah.
Damn, should we just do that real quick?
Yeah, I'm super down. I really try to focus on like the lyrics and then the actual music and then any of like history notes or like weird notes. So it's a great place to start.
Yeah, I mean, like, Spanish lady, come to me. She lays on me this rose. I don't know, really, if we can get too much from that. I mean, probably just some girl, you know. Maybe, I don't know, maybe LSD or something, you know. Rainbow spirals round and round, trembles and explodes. And it left a smoky crater in my mind I'd like to blow away. And then, oh, this one's kind of funny. Hearing him talk about it, then he came around and busted me for smiling on a cloudy day. And there, I guess he threw a water balloon at a cop or something.
Okay, yeah, with Phil Lush. Yeah, we must have been on the same website, I guess.
Yeah, and they took him to jail or something. Yeah, man, wild, you know. And then, I mean, man, this is just such, like, lyric-wise, like, for the first song you ever wrote, really, lyric-wise, I mean, good job, Bobby, you know. Holy moly.
Good job, Bob. I know you're probably watching or listening to this.
Yeah, thank you, Bobby, yeah.
Yeah, so as far as the Spanish lady coming to me and laying on this rose and the rainbow sparkles round and round, it trembles and explodes. I guess the Spanish lady could be some sort of like otherworldly experience, not like specifically just like a lady.
Yeah, absolutely.
And kind of left a big impact on him and busted him on a cloudy day.
Yeah. Busted me for smiling, man. And then, of course, the coming around in a circle. I mean, I don't know, madness, insanity, craziness. Yeah.
Spiraling down the psychedelic path.
Oh, absolutely.
Road tripping until you die.
Yeah, down the rabbit hole, man, like an Alice in Wonderland, you know? And then escaping through the lily fields, I came across an empty space.
So I read there were, like, lily fields in this specific part of... some part of California, Novato, California. The dead used to hang out there, and apparently there's like this creek running through just like north of Novato that has a bunch of lily fields. So they would go there to kind of like decompress from like, I guess, the city or whatever they need to decompress from. So I think that's kind of what he was touching on, escaping through the lily fields.
Yeah, being true hippies, you know, running. Yeah. Nice, that's cool. I didn't know about that. Yeah. Tripled and exploded, left a bus stop in its place.
Okay, so I guess if they're escaping to this place that brings them peace, it turned in to a pinnacle road or bus stop on the bus of their magical
life.
Journey.
Yeah, I mean, yeah.
In the Grateful Dead.
Absolutely, man. Yeah, the bus to it. And then, of course, the bus came by and I got on. That's where it all began. The bus further, yeah.
Yeah, the further bus. And that's, I guess, the specific line where the kind of, you know, the saying comes from.
Yeah, and it was at a Beatles concert, right? When Bob Weir first got on the bus, if I remember correctly reading
that
at some
point.
Or,
that sounds pretty familiar.
Yeah, I mean, what a time period, man. A place and time, you know, like.
Seeing the Beatles and then be starting the Grateful Dead.
Yeah, getting on the bus. And then, of course, to Neil Cassidy, you know, there was Cowboy Neil at the wheel of the bus to never ever land.
Yeah, so he's just playing out and saying it, you know, like naming him, you know.
Absolutely, man. Yeah,
I feel like there's a lot of confusion sometimes, or like people misinterpret it, or maybe it's the other way around for Never Everland. I was guilty of this before I looked more into it, of thinking of like Peter Pan.
Okay, yeah,
but I think he says Never Everland, and Peter Pan is Neverland.
Yeah, that's right. Okay.
So I was getting touches of like Neil Cassidy and Alice in Wonderland and Peter Pan, which is kind of a quite the vibe.
Yeah. Like, oh, absolutely, like, man. Yeah.
Otherworldly and magical and staying young and.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. You know, capturing that, you know, excitement, you know, fresh look on the world, never tarnishing it, you know, that kind of thing. Yeah. And I think maybe that's kind of what they were after, you know, like giving that to people. That's why so many people go to Dead concerts and like forget their entire life, you know, for, I don't know, 4 hours or however long it is.
Yeah. 4 hours or a whole summer or.
Yeah. Oh, this is kind of funny. Yeah. On this, I guess Bob developed it, as I was tripping through the lily fields.
Okay.
Yeah, well, that makes sense. Yeah, 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 okay, I see. Yeah.
I was just saying it. Yeah. I was tripping through the lily fields and the bus got on by and I, that's where it all began.
Oh, man, yeah, 16, 18-year-old Bobby. God, what a life, man.
Yeah. So this is kind of like hippie culture pioneerism in a song.
Oh, absolutely, yeah.
Like, I don't know if there's any other song that, like, goes that far deep and that far back to the actual roots of the people who were honestly involved. Like, I'm sure a lot of songs were maybe written or influenced from him, but never, like, they, like, this band traveled with him and they were good friends with him until he died. I guess he died walking from town to town in New Mexico after a wedding or reception he went to.
Oh, yeah, on the railroad tracks or something, man. Like,
going from one town to another, and I guess in the rain, and somebody just found him the next morning dead. And I guess the it's like the actual cause of death is like was like unknown. They just said like really intense congestion. So, jeez. I don't know what that means.
Yeah, COVID patient zero. Yeah, yeah. Sorry, they shouldn't have re-exhumed the body. Like,
Yeah. Yeah, but down in Mexico, and you're like, who the hell is this guy? And
but now,
I don't know how it got back to in the 60s to the dead that he was dead.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, but I mean, this really is like a lot of people. I don't know, say like White Rabbit or something like that is like the epitome of like the counterculture. Like Jefferson Airplane and like that kind of scene. But this one, like, I mean, I really feel like it just paints the picture, man. You know, it's like exactly like what their ideals are, like. A day in the life of, like, the Grateful Dead early on, names, like, one of the founders of the hippie movement, And, yeah, it's an incredible tune.
And it came to life on his last night of life.
Yeah.
And it's been carried on as, like, this completely separate thing of what it started ever since then. It's a kind of extraterrestrial kind of.
Oh, absolutely. Have you ever seen it live? Performed like by one of the members.
I've seen it quite a bit with Dead & Co. I feel like they play it a lot.
Yeah,
the Dead played it a lot. Obviously, it was one of their oldest songs, but it looks like they played it just under 600 times.
Wow,
from 1967 to 1995.
Yeah, that's a lot of times. Man. Absolutely, yeah. I kind of actually remember when I saw Dead & Company play it. Yeah, it was 2017 in Folsom Field in Boulder, I believe.
Okay.
Yeah, and it was, I was in a state of mind to where it was a really prolific experience, It was like,
sure.
Oh my goodness, man, coming out of drums into it or something like that.
Yeah,
because it's definitely a second set song, this song is.
Yeah, I think when they play it, I would say, like, especially Dead & Company, I feel like it's, like, 90% of the time right after drums and bass.
Absolutely. Yeah, it's very...
And they just, like, lead into it, and you're like, okay, I see what they're doing.
Yeah, I feel like the Dead & Company, like, structure-wise, like, in their set list, definitely has their purely second set songs. Like,
I would say so,
you're going to be, like... real hard pressed to find like a Dark Star or something in the first set, or like, I don't know.
Yeah.
Or even like Stella Blue or something in the first set or anything like
that. Yeah, I think they save like the slower ones like that.
Yeah, and like, woo. Yeah, yeah, the far out ones,
For sure, when the sun's down. And
oh, absolutely.
Feeling good,
Yeah, when it all starts to kick in, Or wind down, depending. Yeah. Absolutely.
What time you started.
Yeah, man, I tell you, like, some of those Dead shows, it's hot. Like, the last one, last summer.
We were there together.
Yeah, we sure were, man.
It was super hot.
Yeah, taking off our shirts. Pouring ice all down. Yeah, drinking little tiny fireballs, or at least I was, man.
Yeah,
which is a horrible thing to drink when it's smoking hot outside. Yeah, would not recommend. Oh, man, that was a blast, though, dude. Yeah. They're playing the same place, right?
They are, yeah. It'll be their third summer in a row coming here, which was nice because the first, was this their, like, eighth summer tour? Seventh? Something like that?
Yeah, 15 was their first, I believe, right?
Yeah, but there was a fall tour.
So oh,
they came
that's
here
right.
in 15,
yeah.
And then they had 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22. All right, this is the eighth summer tour.
They probably didn't do it in 20.
The first
right?
five, they did not come to St. Louis.
Yep.
So it's nice how the last three are coming here. Absolutely, I always had to go somewhere, which was nice because I went to Alpine Valley to see them in 2018. So
it was that was beautiful.
It was super gorgeous. Yeah. And then I went to Chicago a couple times to see him because they weren't playing here.
God, I'd love to go to Chicago and see him this year. What? When are they playing here?
June 7th, 2 weeks from tomorrow.
Wait, nice. So,
yeah, 2 weeks from tomorrow.
Yeah, so everyone in St. Louis, we are getting paid to promote this. Yeah, straight from Bobby Weir's pocket. Yeah, so,
straight from Ticketmaster.
Yeah, so please go there and do it. And I don't know if the tickets are sold out, storm the gates. You didn't hear from us. Yeah.
Dead and Company, promo code DEADTALK1 will get you into the show.
Absolutely. With a miracle. You just got to put your finger up, man. Mm-hmm. Yeah, easy as that, right?
For some people.
I guess, yeah. Yeah, you've had experience. I haven't had experience.
Yeah, I was just being nosy. I was in line for the porta potties one time, and this dude with a badge came talking to this smoking hot chick right behind me.
Yeah.
With a fucking pocket full of tickets. And he's how many you need? And just like talking to her, and I just interrupted. I was like, dude, I had my guitar on me.
Yeah.
And I'm like, man, I will play you any Dead song you want to hear right now for one of those tickets.
Yeah.
And he's like, how about I give you one to not play me any music?
Wow. Oh,
I was like, honestly,
boy.
Dude, I will fucking take it. Whatever.
All right,
whatever
man.
Gets you inside. Yeah. Yeah.
Damn, that's intense. Yeah, that's awesome, though. Yeah, and then, I mean, really, like, if you go, it's so cool how, like, the Dead's always been, you know? If you go and can't get in, I mean, there's Shakedown Street, and there's food and everything
cool
you can
merch.
Imagine.
Like, this is from Jay Lee. I try to get something from them, like, every time I'm on
the nice.
All their clothes are so cool.
Oh, yeah. Speaking
like,
of which, yeah, we both got our little steelies on.
To represent.
Yeah, I found this at, like, a thrift store or something, and then ironed the patch on.
Nice.
Yeah, I had this other button I was gonna wear. It's a Jerry Garcia button, right? And it's on my jean jacket, but man, it looks just like Charles Manson.
Okay.
Yeah, like it looks so much like it to where like I've been wearing it at gigs and stuff. People are like, man, that's an interesting choice, you know? And I was like, no, it's Garcia, man, I promise, you know? Like,
yeah.
I'm in the car, I'll show it to you after, but it's like, oh boy. I mean, it's Jerry with a cigarette and he's full black beard and hair and a little button. Yeah, it's identical, you know, unfortunately.
Okay. Yeah, I only know what he looks like from that Brad Pitt movie, Once Upon a Time in Hollywood.
Oh, yeah. A great
like
film,
a small,
by the way. Yeah,
so
Quentin Tarantino.
For sure,
yeah, that was probably my favorite movie by him, unfortunately. Like, I mean,
I like that, and I like Kill Bill a lot. Kill Bill Part 1 and 2.
Nice.
So good.
Yeah, and then, of course, Reservoir Dogs.
I haven't seen that one.
Oh, that's a good one. Gory, but all of them are. Yeah.
I like gore.
Yeah, Pulp Fiction, classic.
I've fallen asleep every time I've tried to watch that.
Yeah.
All right,
welcome to Tarantino Talk. This is Hunter and Noah. Yeah, good to see you.
All right, so a few facts I try to get out for everyone. I mentioned this the first time they played it, February 3rd, 1968, in Portland, Oregon, at the Crystal Ballroom.
Nice.
There are obviously performances in 67. I found one as early as October 67.
Yeah.
But that was, I like that one being the first one because of the Neil Cassidy thing.
Yeah. And I reckon like, I heard some that like, that's the first time like the lyrics were set properly, you know, and like not just floating around like crazy. And,
it's like, this is how it goes.
Yeah, absolutely. Like the song's fully developed.
Yeah. And then the last time they played it was on the second to last show up in Chicago at Soldier Field on July 8th, 1995.
Wow,
so they played two nights up there, and they played this second set on their first night.
Yeah, and then in 95, they really brought out, like, all of their old tunes, man. Yeah, it's almost like it was like, fortuitous to
sure. Like
Jerry's demise.
Yeah,
and didn't he play Wolf at the last show as well, I'm pretty sure? Mm. Yeah,
I'm
heard
unfamiliar
that.
With which guitar he played at the last show, but that wouldn't surprise me.
Yeah, which is kind of wild, you know? Yeah, Wolf and Tiger, I believe he played both of them because his newer one, Lightning Bolt or something, was having a crazy issue. By the way, I'm sorry if that's missed. Yeah.
No, you're good.
Wolf's,
I'm
but
sure.
I think, I don't know. If not, just take my word for it.
We're on microphone, so everything we say is true, right?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, and then we'll be on YouTube, Spotify, ABC, NBC, CNN,
Fox.
Oh, that's our big supporter, really. Here. Yeah.
But my favorite version is March 9th, 1981 at Madison Square Gardens.
Oh, hell yeah.
That was a release from last summer. I think we talked about it. It's like kind of the green with the really rocking, feels like a stranger opening it up.
Oh, absolutely. Alfea,
you know what I'm talking about?
Yep. I do indeed know what you're talking about.
That other one is really good, which is also right after Drums in Space. So they've been doing that for a while. They did a Uncle John's band into Drums in Space, into the other one, into Stella Blue, all as like one situation.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I mean, if it's broke, don't fix it, you know? Yeah, sure. Yeah. So mine, my favorite one is from, sorry, let me look back at this, is actually from 78, 2378 in Madison, Wisconsin. Right. Yeah, it's a weird one, man. It's like fiery as hell.
Weird.
Yeah,
it's like the weirdest song ever.
It's like Jerry's tone, though, is off the hook, man. It's like he's really just shredding it up, you know, and it's like more of a fast paced one, like,
okay.
You know, that kind of deal.
Yeah. Can I see the cover of it?
Yeah, absolutely. One of those dick pics. Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, I recognize that one. I'll give that one a specific listen and think of you later.
Yeah, this whole show is actually really quite excellent, you know? But yeah, that's my favorite for sure. Yeah. Cool.
Yeah, I've got some other ones on here. One we already talked about, the Skull and Roses one.
Yeah.
Like the one of the original recordings, I feel like. It's like 17 minutes or something.
Oh, absolutely, yeah.
Live at the Fillmore East in New York on April 28th, 1971.
Yep.
And then I had to throw this one in there. It was live at the St. Louis Fox Theater on December 10th in 1971.
Oh, nice. Yeah, yes.
That one's pretty good, but it's here at the Fox.
Yeah.
I've been to the Fox.
Yeah, I've been to the Fox as well, yeah.
I just saw Wicked there like a month ago.
Oh, how was that?
It was good. Yeah. I liked it a lot more than I thought I was going to, actually.
The only time I ever was there, I saw Wilco. Yeah, that was pretty fun. Yeah, it was pretty good, you know? I mean, nice. They're kind of a hometown band as well. Yeah, Belleville, Illinois. Yeah,
I saw a String Cheese incident at the Fox.
Oh, that was pretty cool.
For a two-night run over Easter.
Oh, okay.
In 2018 or 19? I think 19, actually.
Yeah, very cool.
So that was fun. It felt like that's how the Fox should be seen, I feel like, you know?
Yeah, oh, absolutely, man. Yeah, the Dead tried to buy the Fox, right?
They did try to buy the Fox.
Shame on you, St. Louis,
like,
dude.
Fuck no.
They shut that shit down right away.
I'm not letting this happen.
Yeah, what a
bummer,
man.
That's honestly probably for the better, but
I guess so, yeah. They're like, oh, no way. Yeah.
I wonder what that would do to, like, the local community if that happened. Like, do you think St. Louis would be any different now if they actually were successful and still owned it?
Yeah, I'm not sure. I don't know. I feel like if Bill Graham was to take it over, for sure it would have been, you know, during that time period. But did the Dead ever, like, I know the Dead specifically, like, their company was trying to buy it. Did they ever end up buying any other theaters? Just like,
I have no idea. It was, the Terrapin Crossroads, Phil's?
I think that's Phil's.
Specifically,
yeah.
Phil's.
Because that's a newer one, right? Like, that hasn't been around for...
I want to say it just shut down. I don't know. I'm not educated enough on
this. He played there, like, every night for a while, right?
Yeah, it was, like, his main spot. And when the tour ended in, like, California, so I was hanging out in San Francisco, and, like, everyone was going to shows there. I never made it there because they did like a bunch of after Dead & Co. tour stuff, you know?
Yeah, absolutely.
I never made it, but I would like to if it's still going. I don't think it is, but don't quote me on honestly anything.
Yeah, I've never been to San Francisco, actually, man, which is nuts. Okay, yeah, nice. I got to go. I'm going to make it a priority this year, I think.
Yeah. I was there a couple times in 2016 on tour. I got this lightning bolt tattoo on Haight Street.
Oh, cool, man.
I got this Bertha, the Skull and Roses on Haight Street.
Oh, I never even noticed that. That's beautiful, man. Yeah,
thanks.
Damn, on Haight Street, man, that's so cool. Yeah, what a place to get it.
Yeah, that's what I thought. There was a tattoo parlor, I don't know what it's called, But I met a tattoo artist outside. I was just walking around with nothing to do, and he was smoking a cigar, and obviously had a lot of time.
Hell yeah, to do, cigar, man. Yeah, that's what's up.
So I just started talking to him, and he ended up being from St. Louis and was on the opening crew and helped start Trader Bob's Tattoos over on Jefferson.
Oh, okay. Yeah, cool. Well, damn, very cool.
Yeah,
small world, man.
He was saying before 44 was there. He was like, we were really popping before 44 came in, and he was another guy, but he's been living in San Francisco for 20 years or something.
Okay.
So it was just kind of a cool connection getting it from a St. Louis guy out in Hate Street.
Yeah.
Looking at the tattoo parlor, there was some graffiti, and it had Bertha in this style, just kind of like this.
So yeah. I'll take it. Yeah. That's awesome, man. That's another good one to do. Yeah.
Bertha?
Yeah. Are you guys going to do that soon, you think?
I have no idea. I always let the guests choose, So I'm just going to, I guess, keep inviting people on and wait until they choose Bertha. You know, I didn't think I was going to get to the other one for a while, but...
Oh, yeah. No, I got that. Yeah, it was either that or Terrapin Station, and I was
God, I'm so glad you didn't pick that.
Yeah, we would have been in here all night,
trying to learn that. I haven't even tried.
Yeah, we'll leave that to the Jake's Legs guys in St. Louis, man. Okay. Yeah, they do it pretty well, I think.
They do, yeah. And Sean Cannon does it really well, too.
Ooh, yeah, I saw that at the, what was that last Dead show that he played?
The 77.
Yeah, that was phenomenal,
it
man.
It was really great. Yeah, Hillary and I talked a lot about that.
Yeah, of course.
She was singing.
Yeah, shout out to Sean Cannon, man. Yeah, go see him if you're in St. Louis. Yeah.
I think I've talked about him on every episode so far, trying to manifest him on here.
Oh, yeah. Well, we're just going to... Him and then Bobby Weir, they're both going to come on soon, Right. Yeah.
Hillary was telling me to hit up Gary Hunt because he saw Jerry a handful of times.
Yeah.
So he would probably be of good knowledge, so I guess I'm going to go Gary hunting pretty soon.
Gary hunting, indeed, man. Yeah, you already went hunter hunting, now it's time for Gary. I guess Gary Hunt played with, John Hartford and everything, man. Yeah, so that's pretty
I don't
sweet.
Know much about him. I just know that he destroys every instrument in every show he's on with Sean Cannon, so.
Yeah, he's something else, man. Get him on here for sure.
I will try. So it's kind of funny how you picked the other one, because when I did the episode with my brother Jake, we did West LA Fade Away.
Yeah.
And I posted some reels on TikTok or TikToks or whatever you call TikTok videos.
Mm-hmm.
And I got somebody commenting. Shout out to whoever this guy is. What's his name? Charlie T. Chotsky.
Hell yeah.
On TikTok commented... Can you talk about how many flats are in the other one? So I replied to him. I was like, well, we only talk about stuff that the guests choose, so I got to wait till somebody chooses the song, Charlie T. Chotsky. And now here we are talking about it. So is there anything you want to address to Mr. Charlie T. about how many flats are in the song?
Oh, God, flats. I don't know. It's in the key of E, so figure it out for yourself. Yeah, one of those. Yeah, we don't play music, really. We just listen to it. No, but I mean, it's really a relatively, simple song, man.
It goes in between just two chords.
E and D. Yeah. And what I've noticed, jamming on it, is it never really defines the E as, major, minor, seventh, or anything. It just floats around, So,
you can do whatever variation kind of fits the mood, I guess.
You can, yeah. And then, of course, then, the chorus, it goes, the E, D,
that
C,
walk down.
A. Yeah, so it's very much in the key of E, but, I don't know. It doesn't necessarily define it. So I think that's the whole point of this song, man, to be as, open and free as possible with it. And then also, this is a drum song for... It's absolutely insanity,
What's the time signature? 12:08?
Yeah, 8:12, I believe. 8:12. Yeah. I don't know. We're guitar players here, man.
For sure. That was the one reason I was kind of nervous to do this and play it, because of the timing. But I think when we were practicing it, it was sounding pretty good.
Yeah, it sounded pretty good. Well, you guys be the judge of that. Yeah, I think it should go out all right, man. Yeah, but no,
I hope so.
Thank you, Bill and Bobby, for all your jazz, like making it hard for us to play this song.
Seriously. We'll try to do it justice.
Yeah, it's a great tune, man. Really, like, I don't know. And it, to me, it's like always a tune that has really like defined the Dead in my mind, you know, especially early Dead. And like, it's a place in time, like I was saying earlier, you know, like there are songs that you can just listen to and like almost be transported, you know. And I really feel like this is one of those, like, you get transported into like one of Ken Kesey's acid tests or like a San Francisco night, you know, like after a gig, like going through Lily Fields, like maybe still a little stoned or on other substances that are legal, so we can't talk about them, you know?
The drum chaos kind of sends me spiraling into a psychedelic trance of...
Absolutely. Did you read much? Because I read a little bit on how it was, like, recorded for Anthem of the Sun and put together. No. Yeah, so this is really cool. So the whole first part is studio, right? And then it transitions into two live shows that they took. So it's like half studio, half live,
well,
right?
That's cool.
Yeah, and then like, of course, there are still some overdubs on it. Like, I believe the vocals are still overdubbed, but all the drums, when it goes into the like, and like most all the instruments are live.
That's what's
up. And then after, like, you know, the faster we go, the rounder we get or whatnot, that section of it, which is the section that we're covering, the Bobby section and Bill, and then it goes back, like, fades perfectly back into the studio, you know. The other day, they waited,
Wow, so creative, especially for back then. That must have been a lot harder to accomplish.
Oh, God, yeah, with tape and balancing. Yeah, oh, man.
Did we mention the other three songs that were part of this? That's it for the other one.
Yeah,
The Cryptical Envelopment.
Yeah,
is the second song, and then Quadilipit for Tender Feet.
Yeah, if you know how to pronounce that better than us, please. Yeah, but oh my goodness, yeah,
Quadlipit.
Yeah,
Quadlipit. Quadlipit for Tender Feet.
Yeah, you think they were hippies, man? I don't know. Like, no.
They're like, yeah, let's just call it Quadlipit for Tender Feet.
Yeah, hey, good idea, man. Yeah, that's groovy, man. Yeah, and then, the faster we go, the rounder we get.
Which is, again, now the other one, and then goes into We Leave the Castle.
Yep, and essentially We Leave the Castle from listening to it is just a reiteration of the first part and then descends into all the bells and like...
Yeah,
something like that.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
Is there anything else you want to touch on before we wrap it up? I feel like we've got a...
Pretty much
it all covered.
Not really. Just thank you for having me on Dead Talk. You know, it's been an absolute pleasure. Yeah, and
let me know when you want to come back on.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, I'll be back with a fresh terrapin station and help on the way. Okay. Yeah, all those. No, man, it's a blast. You know, this is such a cool idea and like concept. And yeah.
Thanks, man. I really love the Grateful Dead, and I wanted it to be more part of me, and I didn't want to, like, we tried starting a Dead band at one time, but that was just way too hard to like get together, and I was like,
yeah, especially with all the other projects, and man, yeah, there's a lot of Dead bands in this town too, so it was like, we're gonna have to really put in some work,
six to seven members, and getting six to seven people in the same room at the same time is so hard.
Oh, it really is. Yeah.
So I was like, what can I do by myself?
And yeah, hell, I only have four people, man, and it's crazy hard to get them anywhere without, like, a gig being, you know, had. Yeah. It's something like that.
You're opening for Jake's Leg coming up soon,
right?
Well, like, in July?
Yeah, at the Jefferson Barracks, the 26th, I believe. No, never, and rumor has it I'm going to be joining him for a couple of songs as well after play, so that'll be cool.
What songs would you want to play with them?
Oh man, whatever they let me do, but I don't know. It'd be cool
like
to
Terrapin
do.
Terrapin Station.
I want to do it. I want to do all the ones that I really can fuck up. Yeah. You know? just really embarrass myself. You know. Yeah, that's what I like to do, man. You know. But I really don't know, man. I don't know. I love Jammy Dead, you know, Franklin Tower, Fire, things
yeah, you play
like
that one almost every show. I think,
we
right?
we really love to play that one, man. Yeah. You know, and then I don't know, Viola Blues is another favorite of mine to play live. Yeah,
I love that one.
Yeah, that'd be a good one to do as well. That's an old blues song. I'm pretty sure.
Yeah.
Ooh, one more thing I want to say is, sorry that you're not here, Max. We miss you.
My beloved co-host is not here.
Yeah.
Because he's on a date.
He'd normally be right here. Yeah. Good luck, Max. I hope
it's going well.
Yeah. We're sending all the dead vibes out your way, man. Channel Bobby Weir, man.
Yeah.
You know?
It's a second date. So the first day went good enough, I think. So
closer and closer to that third date, man.
He'll get it one of these days.
He'll get it one of these days, man. Yeah. Yeah, well, that's Max for you right there.
So is there anything else you want to plug? Any shows coming up? Any recordings being released? Any videos you want to make sure I link to this? Relating back to your band that you have with your brother?
Yeah. Oh, sure. So let's see here. You're not going to have this out by tomorrow.
I will not. No, there's the one episode ahead of you that I got to edit and release, so...
Well, I don't know. The Hamilton Band, we have like a Facebook, Instagram, and everything. Like he was saying, I mean, we try to like keep busy. We have some residencies around town and like Oyster Bar every last Thursday, 1860s every second Friday and fourth Sunday. And then like try to fill them out in between there. And yeah, we're going into the studio next week, actually.
That's what's
up. Yeah, gonna
Which
record
studio?
Some new tunes. Kalinga Studios, actually.
Okay, nice. I recorded a song there with Ryan.
Yeah, how was it, man? They got great facilities up
there,
man.
It was good.
Man.
It's just a simple pop song, so it didn't take us too long. But
groovy. When do you plan on releasing that?
You know, I have no idea. I go back and forth of wanting it to put it out by myself, and Jake's got some music that he's recorded.
Nice. Maybe make a Woo-Mates little EP.
So we're going to be talking about that pretty soon. He's been working on this massive deck project that's consuming his life, but he's going to finish it tomorrow, and then we're going to get really into like our internet business stuff.
Nice. So, very cool. Yeah. Well, congratulations, Jake.
I'm finishing
the deck.
Seriously.
Big deck energy, man.
I'll put pictures of it. It's like around an above ground pool. It's like 50 by 30. It's fucking huge.
Yeah. Nice. Well, very cool. All right. Well, should we jam?
Yeah. Hunter, thank you very much for participating in this 10th episode of Dead Talk, where we discuss the other one.
Yeah, and the first Bobby song you've done as well.
And the first Bob Weir song we have talked about on the show as well. This is a lot of firsts.
Cheers.
All right, cheers.